Hello and welcome to the Rock Bowl for Week 6 as the Loras College Jewhawks take on the Buena Vista Beavers for homecoming. I'm Hugh Maloney, and joining me is Adam Rodriguez. And Adam, what are you looking for in today's game?
I'm looking for some excitement. You know, both teams coming off two blowout losses. BV losing to our rival down the street, University of Dubuque, and then obviously the Jewhawks coming off a tough loss to Wartburg. So looking for a very physical and exciting game. Both teams definitely want to get back on that in that win column for sure.
Yeah, both teams 2-3 coming into this week. Should be a good matchup on paper. At least that's the way it looks like it's going to be.
Absolutely.
And homecoming, so you know those Jewhawks are going to have that extra energy coming out here with a big crowd at the Rock Bowl looking to perform.
Yeah, definitely. Like you said, that crowd energy always helps this Jewhawk team too. The more energy that crowd gets, the better this team performs. We've seen it time and time again. We saw it their last home game when they took down Nebraska Wesleyan. That crowd really helped them. And that very nice win from the Jewhawks.
Yeah, crowd has been big factors in the Jewhawks season this year as looks like the Jewhawks are on offense. And Adam, going into that, who are the Jewhawks starters for the offense?
Yeah, absolutely. For the Jewhawk offense, starting at quarterback is number 12, Evan England. Behind him, running back will be Ty Bausch. Tight end, Zach Redinger. The wide receivers, Marty McGovern, Michael Crawford, and Damani Brown. And that offensive line, left tackle, Sean Cordulis, left guard, Ben Boffman, center, Connor Durden, right guard, Titus Mullen, and right tackle, Mitchell Huizenga.
Yeah, Jewhawks going to be looking good out here on offense. Starting off first, Evan England, a great young sophomore quarterback. And back to return for the Jewhawks is number 11, Harrison Willis. And the starting running back, like Adam mentioned, number 21, Ty Bausch. A couple weeks ago, you guys saw muff kick earlier in the game, so hopefully Jewhawks figure out their special teams issues as we are underway.
Oh, gosh.
And right off the bat, Harrison Willis drops it, but he recovers at the 25 and brought down around the 26-yard line. And right off the bat, Adam, we saw right there a little struggle on special teams.
Yeah, and like exactly like you mentioned, we saw a muff at the beginning of the game against Nebraska Wesleyan. Luckily, Willis able to get down to about that 25, so not a bad area to be after a muff right at the start of the game. So hopefully Jewhawks can march down the field here now.
Your backfield for the Jewhawks, Evan England, Ty Bausch with Jamal Britt lined up next to Sean Cordulis at the bottom of your screen there. Marty McGovern, receiver, as well as Jaheim Haynes. They hand it off to Bausch as he's brought down after a gain of 3 yards. Ty Bausch, one of those players that for the Jewhawks, everything runs through.
Absolutely. Yeah, I mean, if it's not in his hands, you know, they're definitely linked past to be, like you said, definitely goes, a lot goes through Bausch. I mean, why wouldn't it? Mm-hmm. Stud running back for the Jewhawks.
As Ty's motioned out left, England gets a snap. Quick drop back, looking to air it out early to Crawford. And that one led just a little too far to the sideline, incomplete.
Good luck. Love the attack there from the Jewhawks early. I'm trying to get something going, get some energy, get the energy going.
Cordell Johnson, number 20, the cornerback on that play, a 6'4 freshman from Houston, Texas, playing cornerback for the Beavers. And Adam, going off that, who are the Beavers' starters on
absolutely,
defense?
Absolutely. On that defensive line, on the edge we got 99, Landon Weber, defensive tackle, Jordan Anderson. The other edge, R.J. Rojas. The linebackers for the Beavers, Brady McConaty.
Oh, what a catch by Jamal Britt. One-handed, looking like a wide receiver and not a running back.
A beautiful catch there from Britt. Back to the Beavers lineups. Those linebackers, Brady McConaty, Jeremy Woodward, Corey Kitt, Nick Morsehead, and the cornerbacks, Micah Cooper and Cordell Johnson, and the safeties, Brandon Lance and Nico Flores.
So should be a good game on both sides. England gets a two-step drop back, throws over the middle to McGovern.
Another first down.
Old Reliable with another catch for the Jewhawks. Marty McGovern, him and that sophomore, Evan England, really built a connection thrown to his senior wide receiver. England and Bausch in the backfield as Jewhawks go hurry up here. England hands it off to Ty. Ty trying to bounce it outside. Bounce outside again still and keeps those legs turning for a gain of around 5 yards.
Offense looking really good here in the early stages of this game. Hopefully I can keep this going.
A lot better change of pace than last week where Jewhawks only put up 3 points. But Wartburg is a great team, and they've only allowed one touchdown all year. and they were ranked number 21st, and it's always hard to go into Warburg and win.
Yeah, definitely.
As Ty with another handoff here tries to cut back up, but he's met by a Beaver defender in R.J. Rojas, the senior defensive lineman from Newell, Iowa. Third and short here for the Duhawks, a test early. They hand off to Ty. Ty trying to get it, and looks like he's going to be short by the way the officials are spotting him. This leaves Coach Hominiak with the decision early in the game on fourth down.
Good third down stop there for the Beavers. Let's see if they can hold Duhawks here on fourth and two.
Offense trying to get the play in here. England and Bausch in the backfield. Your receivers are Crawford, Haynes, and McGovern. England hit hard right before he could even throw it. And for the Beavers, that is number two. Alan Pernda coming in hot off the corner blitz, and England didn't have a chance.
He just super easy for him to get in there. England just a little helpless there.
Almost looked like it could have been an RPO with
the
option with Ty there. And Duhawks turn over on downs, bringing up the Beaver offense.
Yeah, for that Beaver offense, quarterback number 6, Zach Herrera. Behind him, running back number 5, Mason Griffith. Wide receivers are Dylan Laughlin, Andre Booker, Kendrick Banks, and Jeremiah Powell. That front line, left tackle.
Aaron out early here, and what a catch as Jace Gwynn kind of got burnt in that zone coverage a little bit, coming over the middle for the catch. Looks like that was number 0 for the Beavers. Jeremiah Powell, a 6'1 freshman.
Yeah, definitely. Back to their line. Left tackle, James Fascio. Number 67, Julian Bentoncourt. Center, Anthony Domingue. And right guard, Noah Furman. And right tackle, Brady Madsen.
Yeah, this offensive line, it's a young one, only one junior. The rest are sophomore or freshmen. So see how Coach Defense Coordinator Greg Bauer wants to attack that line early here in this game. As the Beavers hand it off for a gain of around 4 yards to their running back, Mason Griffith. Who the Duhawks got in their starting defensive line here?
On that defensive side, that front line is number 95, Blaine Jordan. Number 97, Elijah Dirtz. And number 35, Sean Doyle. The linebackers for the Duhawks, number 36, Brandon Phelps. Number 45, Josh Kiefer. Number 43, Andrew Heffel. And number 2, Mason Morris. Their secondary, number 3, Brett Bauer. Number 26, Zach Kemp. And number 7, Joey Foley. And number 5, Jace Gwynn.
They try the screenplay here, and that's going nowhere. As there is Jace Gwynn making the tackle. The screen pass no good, bringing up third down for the Beavers. As you see the replay coming up right here. Maybe. There it is.
There we go.
As you just see all the Duhawks just swarming them, as there's Josh Kiefer, that leader of the defense, number 45. Always around the ball, Adam.
Yeah, he always is. I mean, wherever that ball is, expect to see 45.
Mm-hmm. Herrera getting a drop back as he's laid out as he throws it. But I believe that was number 95, Blaine Jordan and Josh Kiefer.
Kiefer, like you said.
Brings up fourth down and 11 for the Beavers. It looks like the offense is going to stay out there. They may be in that lose-lose situation, no man's land, some people would call it. Receivers out there for the Beavers. They got three of them. The bottom of your screen, it's Laughlin. Then at the top, it's number 7, Dolan Prosfilka. And I believe that's number 0, Jeremiah Powell. As Herrera's dropping back, looking to air it out deep.
Mm.
And he's got a fumble, but that ball will be knocked out of bounds. Oh, they're going to say it's a catch, but number 26 for the Duhawks, I believe that's Zach Kemp, saying that ball's incomplete. He's got a strong case to make here.
Yeah, definitely.
And they're going to move the chains. First down here for the Beavers. First time in the red zone for either team today. As they're on their Duhawk 19-yard line and looking to score here.
It's a nice fourth down conversion from the Beavers. Good pass there from Herrera. And a just better catch and from the receiver.
They hand off to Griffith. And that's going nowhere. That young offensive line, like we said earlier, maybe have some troubles against this more experienced Duhawks defensive line.
And if you're the Beavers, with that young line, you just got to be excited for the future with them. Just build up that experience like Duhawks have on their team. So that line will be, they'll figure it out in the next few years, and I wouldn't be surprised if they're one of the better ones.
Yeah, the Beavers have a lot of freshmen and sophomores on this team, so 2-3 coming into this year, but definitely looking for the future with all these sophomores and freshmen they got playing right away.
Absolutely.
As Herrera's going to hand off to Griffith again. He's got a hole, and he hits it right away, making it a shorter third down than second and 11. Looks like it's going to be third and maybe five. Eli Dirtz on the tackle, the junior. So Herrera and Griffith. Looks like they're going to be in the shotgun formation once again here. Three receivers at the bottom of your screen, one at the top. Beavers like to throw the ball. As Herrera gets a four-step drop. Going to the end zone. Looking for his man. No good. No flag on the play. Mason Morris, the defender there.
Coverage. Herrera, a lot of pressure from that Forest defense. It looked like Foley, and I think it was also Jordan listening hard right at Herrera. But, I mean, good look. Just a little long for his receiver.
Yeah, the pressure definitely impacting the throw there for Herrera as the kicker, coming out for the Beavers. I believe that's Michael Odom. Ramon Garcia, the senior. Garcia's field goal is up and no good.
Wow.
That's huge for the Duhawks. This crowd getting into it a little bit after, you know, that first possession. They're looking to score here as Monty Brown's going to get some action coming off a little bit of an injury throughout this week in practice, which is why he didn't get the start. But Monty Brown, definitely an X factor for the Duhawks as he is second in conference in receiving yards coming into today. That shows why him and Evan English have such a good connection. So he can trust him and airs it out to him. As coming into today, Monty Brown has 471 yards receiving. The leader, Ryan New from Central, has 509. So Monty's right behind him as they hand off to Ty again. And Ty's just had nowhere to run these first couple possessions for the Duhawks.
Yeah, you know, you mentioned that Monty and England connection. I mean, you see it constantly. I mean, it's got to be a little bit of that sophomore connection, right? But, yeah, always a nice little threat that the Duhawks have, and then to be lined up with Crawford and McGovern as well.
Yeah, McGovern and Crawford, two seniors, been around a while and impact players for the Duhawks. So definitely a lot of weapons for England to go to, which is why he's also second in conference in passing yards as well. England, three-step drop, gets out to Ty in the flat. Time makes one man miss and another says get off me and gets around a 5 yard gain there for Ty. Just some power running by Ty there, or I should say power receiving, because he caught that one. I believe it was number 14 Brandon Lance, the safety, making the tackle there. Duhawks going to hurry up here on third down. You have to Ty in the flat trying to make something happen, a little bit of a screen play, and Ty is brought down, looks like a yard short by, once again, Brandon Lance for the Beavers. Looks like it's going to be bring up fourth down here, and I'd assume the punt team would come out with where the Duhawks are located.
Yep, and it looks like they are going to bring them out, and Aiden Driscoll will be doing the punting for the Duhawks today. And for the Beavers, their punt returner, number zero, Jeremiah Powell.
Yeah, and Driscoll had a pretty decent week punting last week. 10 total punts for 372 total yards. And two of them went for 50-plus yards as well.
They're going to have Kemp doing the punting, I believe.
Coach Helminiak is not happy. Don't know if it's with his players or the official, but he's red hot down there.
Yeah, he's not happy. Well, and just looking at the American flag and even the flags on the field goal post, wind is blowing at Kemp or Driscoll. Mm-hmm. So this punt definitely going to be a harder punt for them, even kicking field goals over on that Beaver side.
Yeah.
It's going to be tough today to factor in that wind.
As it looks like there's something going on with Driscoll or the officials. I don't know which one. don't know if it's something with the tire that he's wearing or what, but.
Pointed down at the pants of Driscoll.
I mean, I don't think Driscoll's really switched up any of his attire over the season, so
yeah,
I don't know what the deal would be today
all of a sudden
with it.
Now.
But Driscoll will be doing the punting, and Helminiak is still not happy down there. Driscoll waits the snap. Driscoll's kick up and away, and it's a good one here for the Duhawks. Depending on the bounce here, goes really nowhere on the bounce, just a little more sideways.
Yeah.
It was a good punt there from Driscoll, especially into the wind, to at least get on the opposite side of the 50 and allow the Duhawk defense to do what it does and make plays.
Yeah, and even though, the wind doesn't, right now it doesn't look terrible, but you just got to remember up top, it's probably blowing 5-10 miles an hour faster up top than it would be how you feel it.
Herrera and Griffith in the backfield again for the Beavers. Four receivers out wide. You'll be seeing that a lot today from them. They don't have a tight end listed on their roster.
Nope.
Herrera hands off to Griffith here and gets maybe a yard. I believe that was Milo making the tackle there for the Duhawks, the senior, number 42.
Griffith with the carry, tackled by number 42, Milo Collier, and Marcus Lampley.
Marcus Lampley also making the tackle there with the Duhawks. Same personnel in for the Beavers here. Chase Gwynn, number 5 on your screen there with Mason Morris, number 2. Herrera, little halfback screen. Going absolutely nowhere by the Duhawks. That was number 22 for the Duhawks making the tackle. Dawson Charlie, the senior. That was just a good sniff out there by the whole Duhawk defense, realizing what was happening and getting back and making that tackle.
You know, other than that last week against Wartburg, I mean, this Duhawk defense, definitely always very solid throughout the season. Obviously, the rough game versus the Knights, but they bring a lot of energy for this team. Help them win a lot of games.
Griffith motioned out wide, throwing it over the middle into double coverage, and that one's knocked incomplete. Nice. Zach Kemp and Jace Gwynn, the defenders there, to knock that one down.
Beautiful coverage by the two seniors there.
That'll be a 3-and-out for the Beavers as they bring out the punt team, and it looks like it's Marty McGovern back deep to return for the Duhawks.
Yeah, doing the punting day for the Beavers is number 17, Matthew Byswinger.
Byswinger's punt almost gets blocked. And Marty McGovern's going to let this one bounce, and it takes a little bit of a Duhawk bounce. As that one's going to be downed around the Duhawks' own 30-yard line. Now, see if this Duhawk offense can get something going here. Really, nothing happened that second drive. That first drive was good until that fourth down.
Yeah.
And what do you think some adjustments the Duhawks can make early here, Adam, to get the ball down the field?
I don't know. I definitely would like to see some, maybe some more passes over to Monty or even McGovern or Crawford. Mm-hmm. They're capable of getting downfield, making some very, very solid catches, those three. And England's got the arm to get us downfield for sure. So definitely some more passing to them as well.
They do a little bit of a screenplay, Jaheim Haynes, and England overthrew him on that one, and that's definitely a ball that I'm sure Coach Helminiak's not happy with. I'm sure England's not happy with on his own.
Yeah, that's definitely one England's going to want back. I want to have a do-over for.
England alone in the backfield, 5 wide receivers lined up out wide. England gets a snap, quick two-step drop back. And that ball got almost spiked into the ground right in front of Jamal Britt. And maybe that pressure got to England a little bit, forced him to throw that one into the ground, bringing up 3rd and 10. As your receivers are Michael Crawford, Monty Brown, Jaheim Haynes, and Marty McGovern at the top of your screen. Haven't seen Ty at all in this drive.
Just been Britt out there alongside of them.
pistol formation here for the Duhawks. England quick drop back. Getting out early to Monty There's Brown, who's got the first down. Yep. Maybe hopefully that'll get the Duhawks offense going and Evan England getting some confidence in them.
Definitely. There's that connection we were talking about, that England to Brown. Wouldn't be surprised if we see a lot more of that today.
And the folks saw in the Nebraska Wesleyan game, England and Brown connected for 133 yards between those two receiving. So Brown had half the receiving yards. They dump it off to Jamal Britt in the backfield trying to make a guy miss, and that doesn't do anything for him.
Smet right at the line just about.
Haven't seen these screenplays that the Duhawks are drawing up really work so far in this game, so be interesting to see if they stick with that or go away from it.
Yeah, it just looks like BV's just reading them perfectly. Mm-hmm. They're almost expecting the screen almost every time they line up for a pass.
England and Britt in the backfield. Same personnel so this whole drive. England's going to be a QB keeper. He's got some green grass ahead of him. He's bouncing to the outside for the first down. That's just a great design QB run. Got Buena Vista to bite on it as you see Bausch checking back in for the Duhawks. As we get a look at this replay. Sold the pass. Then England had the smartness to tuck it down and just make people miss and use his athleticism and pick up the first down.
Great design. That's the nice thing about England, too. He's got the arm to throw a long ball, and he's got the legs. He's got the speed, too. Bausch on that outside.
Thought Ty might have been able to spring that one real quick for a second. Ty, one of the offensive leaders of this team, as well as big left tackle Sean Cordless. England fakes it to the flat, going over the middle. He's got a man, Jamal Britt, down the sideline. Britt working it in for the touchdown for the Duhawks. And Jamal Britt hitting his dance, too. Jamal Britt looking like a wide receiver today and not a running back. Might have to switch his listing up on the roster.
Absolutely. Just a beautiful pass there from England over the middle to Britt. Mm-hmm. And, Britt, just such a strong dude, just carrying the BV defender on his back. It's hard to take that man down.
Yeah, Jamal is a big guy and definitely somebody that I would not want to run into. Listed at 5'11", 220, and he's all of that.
Yeah, big dude, a lot of energy.
Yeah, Scott's kick is up, and it is good for the Duhawks. As there you see a very packed Rock Bolt, and the crowd is happy to get a score on the board early.
Absolutely.
As you see the replay here, that previous touchdown, or the extra kick, I should say. You see the kick there?
Beautiful
kick is up and good.
Beautiful kick from Scott.
Yeah. Scott against Nebraska Wesleyan went 7-for-7 as well, so he's on a bit of a roll, I should say. Hopefully not jinxing him here, but he's been pretty well for the Duhawks after, a hard first couple weeks.
Well, and you think back, Scott, the 1-2 give the Duhawks the game winner against Nebraska Wesleyan last season. Put him in. I think he's just got something against Nebraska Wesleyan. Yeah. Always seems to go off against them.
Hopefully it's just conference games.
Maybe
Duhawks and
gotta be
win a couple of those. There's a little bit of a low
screamer.
Kick here, and the Beavers recover it around the 26 yard line. Scott not allowing anything to happen on that kick return.
No.
Three minutes and 32 seconds left to go here in this first quarter, where it's been a little bit of a defensive matchup so far. Only one touchdown, and the Beavers missing that field goal earlier, too. Let's see how that plays into the rest of the game. Herrera and Griffith in the backfield once again for the Beavers. Four receivers out wide. Griffith with the handoff, bounces it outside to the right. makes something out of nothing there as he's met by four Duhawks. I believe it was Brett Bauer in the backfield that missed him right away and slowed him up for the other Duhawks to make the tackle.
Good read by Griffith there to take it on that outside, get a few yards here for him. Now second and four for this Beavers offense.
I assume Beavers will try and go with another run here to Griffith as Herrera is looking at the play one more time. Hands off to Griffith, and he's met right away by the Duhawks. Number 36, Brandon Phelps, did not bite on the fake.
You know, coming into this game, BV only 29% on third down conversions, where Loris sitting at 43.6%. So probably just a little bit of struggles for this Beaver offense, converting on the third downs and getting another life with first down. So let's see if they can convert one here.
Beaver's motion a man over. Griffith rolling out to his left, looking to throw into the flat. And that ball's
that's going to be
incomplete. He caught the ball, but he was bobbling it, and therefore no possession, which leads to a fourth down for the Beavers as they're going to punt again. Pascal Hall, the intended receiver on that play, another freshman. McGovern. Back to receive for the Duhawks, see if he can make something happen here. Beavers definitely hoping for a better punt than that last one.
Definitely.
Which allowed the Duhawks to score off of it. And this punt is better than the last one. McGovern catches it, tries to make something happen. Bounce it to the right side. He's at the 40.
Oh, my gosh.
He's at the 45.
Oh, my gosh.
And he is met by the Beavers.
Good return.
Special teams is something Coach Omeniak talked about after the Nebraska-Wesleyan game that is. Maybe possibly cost them some games. It almost cost them the win against, at the time, number 12 Central when they muffed a punt late in the fourth quarter. But luckily, that didn't cost them. But I know in Eau Claire, there's a couple of missed field goals. And, you want to start seeing that turn around because special teams, even though it may seem like a small part of the game, it wins or loses you them.
Well, especially those field goals. I mean, it's points. You want to get points on the board. So missing field goals definitely – that hurts a little bit more.
It's Killian Pritchett checked in for the first time today. It's his first run for 1 yard. At tight end for the Duhawks, number 19, Zach Redinger. Sophomore from Morris, Illinois. England, quick drop back. Looking for Crawford, and Crawford not able to bring it down one-handed. And once again, England's pass is a little high. That seems like it's been a theme today for his passes. Bringing up third and nine here for the Duhawks. Crawford, Brown, Haynes, and McGovern are the receivers out wide. And it in the backfield. England, two-step drop back. Looking to get to McGovern in the corner, and McGovern caught that for the first down. It was a good job by England fitting in that tight window, and even better concentration by McGovern to come down with that, especially right by the sideline.
Just a nice little dime there from England. Like you said, just finding that right little that pocket right there from McGovern.
As they hand off to Pritchett. And Pritchett's got some daylight. He's got one man to beat. Pritchett down the sideline. Touchdown for the Duhawks. Killian Pritchett loves playing at home. Gets another touchdown on the year. KP just an animal out there running away from all the defenders. Bringing some life here now at the Rock Bowl.
That boy is quick. Right up the gut, and no one was catching that man. One-on-one, it's definitely hard to catch up to Pritchett.
It was the Duhawks 13-0 lead. Scott's kick is up, and it is good, giving the Duhawks a 14-0 lead. As we're going to see a replay here of KP. Adam, what do we see here?
I mean, just wide open field. Great, mm-hmm. great blocking from that offensive line, allowing KP to find that middle and just, yeah, right there, that one-on-one with the Beaver defense. And, yeah, that KP's going to win that 10 out of 10 times.
Pritchard's a good guy to have around you on the team, a nice guy, works really hard, and just all around a great player and great person.
Definitely.
If you're the Beavers, Adam, how important do you think it is for them to get a score right here?
Oh, very. Down 14-0 with a minute left in this first quarter. You want to get something going, especially going in that second quarter right before half. But, so yeah, definitely score is huge here. Whether it's just a field goal, just get points on the board for some confidence. You don't want to end this quarter sitting at a goose egg.
Scott gets his kick away, and it's a good one as the Beavers at the 20 now, returning it, trying to cut it up outside, and met at the sideline, right around the 25-yard line. Good hit there by the Duhawk special teams. Buena Vista on their own 26-yard line here. Herrera and Griffith, the duo in your backfield. Griffith, the handoff, going up the middle, met by that Duhawk defensive line. Oh, and they're going to say the ball came out, but it looks like officials are going to say he's down. Dawson Charlie with the tackle on the play for the Duhawks. Same personnel for the Beavers, as they have Andre Booker lined up at the tight end spot. They'll probably motion him out wide or something. They fake the handoff to Griffith, thrown it deep into nowhere. Almost thrown it to the Duhawks there, as Duhawks on defense, I believe that was Zach Kemp, number 26, and it was.
Yeah, just an underthrown ball from Herrera. I mean, no shot reaching his receiver there.
And that's how you get turnovers. You get a lot of interceptions off of throws like that one right there. Yeah, and Zach Herrera coming in the year does have 8 interceptions as well, so the turnover bug has been a problem for him for sure.
Definitely.
The Beavers, Herrera dropping back in out quick. Just running back. Oh, he's got Griffith open down. Got a blocker down to the 45-yard line of the Duhawks. That was a great pass by Herrera. Leading Griffith past his man and allowed him to pick up 20, 30 yards.
A lot of room for him. And they're just going to let this clock run down.
After one quarter, your Loras Duhawks 14, Buena Vista Beavers nothing at homecoming. And what'd you like in that first quarter?
I love the air attack out of the Duhawks on the first touchdown. Right before we talked about it, airing it out a little bit and getting downfield. The offense looking great, and a beautiful run from Pritchett. So definitely the offense working well right now, and defense as good as it always is, right? BV, slow start for this offense. So maybe we'll see a score here from them on this drive as the second quarter gets ready to begin. But, yeah, their defense not looking too bad, just a couple big plays from Duhawk. So definitely are in for a very exciting second quarter and second half.
Yeah. And something about this Duhawk defense that I think you can't talk enough of is the defense coordinator, Greg Bauer. Players love him. He's definitely a player coach, and that kind of shows on defense.
Absolutely.
Why they just are almost like a steel curtain, almost, if you will.
Definitely. I mean, down on the side, typically when I'm down on that sideline, I mean, you can just see the energy from him. He's very passionate about it. He's passionate about what he does. Definitely wants to help these guys win games, and you can just see it. So you gotta love him for his passion and energy.
Yeah, definitely. Getting back into action here as the Beavers looking a little bit of a run set here. Everybody bunched in the box as the Duelks are kind of stacking it right now. Herrera fakes the handoff, and it's a screen pass to Booker. Booker bouncing around on the outside and goes nowhere.
Good tackle.
Good tackle there by the Duelks in open field, like Adam said. I believe that was Kemp again.
Yep.
And Zach Kemp has just been everywhere for the Duelks today.
I'd say he's another one of those guys, just like Kiefer, where he's always near the ball, I feel like. Anywhere the ball is, Kemp's name will most likely be said. Mm-hmm.
Griffith and Herrera. That common backfield back there as they pitch it off to Griffith. Griffith got a few blockers, and the Duelks are just swarming to the ball. Bring up third and six, it looks like.
Yeah, that front line of the Loris defense doing a lot of work right now, making it very tough for this Beaver run game and even these little screen passes to get going.
Big third down here for the Beavers. Have to imagine they'll punt if they don't pick anything up here. Three receivers at the bottom of your screen there. It's Herrera getting a deep drop back and pressured early, and good pass deflection by who else but Zach Kemp. As that brings up a fourth down here for the Beavers, and offense is kind of wandering over the sideline. Looks like they're going to kick it. Fourth down here for the Beavers as they're going to punt it away here. Looking to pin the Duelks deep. Taking his time on the punt. It's a good one here. And it's going to bounce into the back of the end zone. Putting the Duelks on the 20-yard line. First down here for the Duelks, and they score in their past previous two possessions, looking to keep the offense rolling coming into the second quarter. England and Bausch in the backfield. Monty Brown in press coverage, bottom of your screen. Bausch gets it, and nowhere to run once again, and it's been like that throughout that first quarter, and looks like it's kind of spreading into the second quarter as well. But Bausch is one of those running backs that's a volume back, and he gets better going into the game and later in the game.
Absolutely.
England fakes it to Ty. Doesn't see anything. He's pushed out of the pocket. He throws it to, I believe that's Harrison Willis for the catch. Great poise there by England to not scramble out of the pocket and just shift over. Third down here for the Duelks. Looks like it's going to be third and three. As the Beavers have a lot of people in the box here. You can see the bottom of your screen, press coverage. England looks like he's throwing it up to Dwayne, and that's going to be pass interference. Yeah, that was pretty clear there what was going on. And the intended target was Dwayne Emulis, the senior from Cape Coral, Florida. Cape Corral, I should say. As we're going to get the official word here from our officials.
Yeah, that should give the Duelks a first down here.
A probably a pass interference call and placed at the spot of the foul because it was within 15 yards.
I believe that was first penalty of the game, was it not? Yeah.
Might have been yeah, that was first one. You're correct. It's been a clean game so far. There's a handoff to Ty, and Ty fighting just to even get to the line of scrimmage. Bring up second and 10 once again here. As you got Damani Brown, Harrison Willis, and Dwayne Emulis in the game now for the Duhawks at receiver. As well as Zach Renninger at tight end. Willis motion over there. A little bit of a touch pass. Get Willis out in space. Good block by Ty.
Oh, yeah.
That was a good play there by Duhawks to get it to third and manageable now. Looks like it's going to be around third and two. As there you see Harrison after that good run and touch pass catch. England quick drop back, getting out early to Dwayne, who high points that ball, and what a catch.
Beautiful catch.
I believe England took a hit at the end of that play as well.
And again, that's, I mean, props to Dwayne for that beautiful catch, but another almost overthrown ball from England.
I think the pressure may be into England just a little bit. There's kind of, as you see, he hasn't really been able to do a three-step drop back. It's usually just catch it and turn.
Yeah.
Which is partially the way this offense is designed, going from the pistol formation as they motion over. Wide receiver for the Duhawks, they hand it off to Ty, who goes nowhere. And
met again at the line.
Just nowhere for Ty, like you said, Adam, to run. Is like that all day as Johnny Carson, the second, checked in for the Duhawks, number three.
I mean, props to that Beaver front line, though. Ty usually getting a good amount, like 3-4 yards on those runs, but yeah, props to that Beaver line for stopping him very quickly.
Duhawks hand off to Carter, who just checked into the game. Carson, excuse me, and losing yards on the play is Johnny Carson. Gonna bring up third and 11 here for the Duhawks on the Beaver 44-yard line.
Duhawks in that first quarter were 3 of 5 on third down conversions. Not bad. Not bad at all. See if they can get another one here.
Looks like Beaver's going to call a timeout here, discuss this third down, which will lead us to discuss it. Adam, what do you expect the Duhawks to maybe run up here for a pass play?
You know, I'm looking to see someone like Monty or McGovern or just one of those two up the middle or so. Just get something. Get us first down. Get us close to that red zone and hopefully get another score and go up 21-0 here in the second quarter. Hopefully England can get a nice little drop back here and get some stay cool and maybe get it right to the chest on one of these guys here.
Evan's playing well in that first half. He had, I believe it was 95 passing yards, so definitely balling out for the Duhawks as always.
95 and 7 for 11. Definitely starting well.
He's an efficient quarterback. Always, usually above sometimes that 50% completion mark, which you love to see.
Absolutely. Well, and again,
And he's throwing the ball a lot, too. It's not like he's thrown it 14 times a game, usually up to the 20s or 30s by the end of it.
Well, that's another good thing about England. He can air it out, like we've seen and mentioned earlier, but he's got the speed to go out and just take it himself if he needs to. Nice little dual threat they got with England. Sophomore, too, so you got him for two more. Duhawks are very lucky to have this man.
England, three-step drops, getting out to Carson in the flat, overthrew him a little bit, not allowing Carson the second to catch up to that one. Bringing up fourth down. It was the right idea for the Duhawks as well.
Yeah.
Johnny Kaysen, excuse me. Driscoll back out here to punt again for the Duhawks.
Punting with the wind behind him. He's a little downwind here.
Look for him to try and kick it out of bounds, maybe.
Yeah, definitely. Flags are moving, so that wind is cooking.
And it looks like Duhawks going to be moving back is what the Beavers are thinking. As we'll get the official call right here from our head official. False start on the Duhawks. And that's something that defense coordinator and special teams coach Greg Bauer is not happy about, is losing yards, especially on a punt. But maybe in that situation, it's not the worst thing because you give Driscoll more room to maybe
try and get a bounce. Downwind. And that, like I said, these flags are they're moving pretty good right now.
Driscoll's punt on his way. And they're going to let it bounce. And no, the Duhawks aren't going to be able to get to it.
Good effort. Good effort by that Duhawk special team.
Almost held up in time, but just almost outkicked the coverage there. And Beavers will start from their own 20-yard line.
See if the Beavers can get something going here with their offense. Still sitting at zero. Not much done yet from them. See if we can get a little something out of them.
Herrera at quarterback in the shotgun formation. 15 seconds on the play clock. They snap it, looking to throw it deep. And that ball's intercepted, through right to the Duhawks. And I believe that's Jace Gwynn down the side, not sideline, middle of the field. And he's brought down around the 26-yard line. And that was Jace Gwynn with the interception. Just running down the Duhawk side. Getting the crowd into it. Big interception for the Duhawks. As you see the replay, and Adam, what was going on in this throw here?
Yeah, I mean, we mentioned it. Herrera, a couple underthrown balls we've already seen. And, again, there's another one. And it turned out poorly for him, giving him his ninth interception on the year. It's, like I said, the underthrown, very dangerous. Four quarterbacks.
As it gets to Ty, and Ty's got nothing but room ahead of him. A couple of Beavers to beat, and they just let him walk in, and Ty gets the Duhawks another touchdown, and man, are they rolling right now.
Yeah, they really are. Again, beautiful blocking by that O-line from the Duhawks. And then, yeah, just giving Ty open field. It's hard to stop him as well.
It's definitely something that That was Jace's second interception of the year. She'll put him second on the team right behind Joey Foley. Scotty's kick is up, and it is good. Scotty's staying hot for the Duhawks, as the Duhawks offense is staying hot in general. Here's a replay, the touchdown at the end there. Beavers just basically gave up on that one. And Ty just stays hot for the Duhawks, leading them in touchdowns overall on the year. Been a workhorse for the offense.
You know, he always is. Last year, definitely a workhorse as well. I mean, a lot of it goes through him. I mean, why wouldn't it with how good he is?
There you see the crowd, and they're still here. Hopefully the numbers come back the same after halftime with the big tailgate going on as well.
Right, right.
Duhawk special teams lined up there for the kick. Beavers got three people back there returning their kicks. Looks like it's Powell, Griffith, and Booker maybe.
Yeah.
Scott's kick is away. It's a good one.
Good kick.
Booker
muffed it
off his hand. And there's going to be a scrum for that ball. I already know there. It'll take a while. The Duhawks say they have it.
I think they got it.
It looks like the Duhawks are going to have the ball.
Yeah.
Duhawk ball after you see special teams muffing it. And I almost want to say Zach Kemp came up with that ball as well.
Yeah.
I see a replay here. As the Duhawks look to put this one away early. As you see Booker right there in the middle of your screen, the freshman. Just boom, right off his face mask.
Helmet.
Didn't know where that ball went. And then at that point, it's who wants the ball more.
Whoever wants it.
As the Duhawks are looking to maybe put this one away before halftime.
Yeah.
.9:26 left to go here in this first half of homecoming. Your Loras Duhawks 21, Buena Vista Beavers 0. As the offense looking to make it maybe 28-0 after this drive. Timeout here. As Buena Vista's whole team is probably getting a talking to from the head coach for them.
Yeah,
definitely not happy. I'm sure Coach Mullering, is not happy about.
No, absolutely not.
How this team's performing right now?
Yeah, I mean you're down 21-0 and you're just coming off of a muff punt turnover, and now letting the Duhawks already in the red zone, looking to put it up 28-0. So you cannot be happy at all with the performance right now.
There's a little misdirection here to Harrison, and the Beavers sniffed that one out.
Yeah.
It was a good idea, maybe up 21-0, try a little something, try a little trick play, see if you can get something going as Wills checks out and Haynes checks back in. Haynes, Brown, and McGovern, all three receivers, as you see right there, bottom of your screen. And Britton Bausch, the running back's in for the Duhawks. Britt motions out to the right, into the flat. It's going to be QB keeper for England, and nowhere to go for him.
Net right away.
Duhawk offensive line maybe not able to hold their blocks there as the clock is ticking here for 3rd and 9 on the Beavers' 14-yard line. Be a real shame for the Duhawks if they only get a field goal here, wouldn't you say, Adam?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, driving excellent field positions. Yeah, definitely do not want to settle for a field goal. Hopefully they can find their way into that end zone.
England dropping back, going for that end zone up to Monty Brown, and he catches it. Monty Brown mossing the defender.
Oh, sweet sassy molassy.
Monty Brown is that guy. He's got that dog in him, if you didn't know already. Monty Brown high-pointing that ball on the defender's head as you see him run off, saying, "Put it on a poster."
Let them know.
Monty, I'm going to need you to print it and sign it to me, buddy. That's going to up on the wall.
Let them know, young man. Let them know.
As Scott lines up here for the kick. This kick is up, and everyone for the Duhawks is having themselves a day.
Yeah. And if that doesn't excite you, then I don't know what does, honestly.
As you see the replay coming up here, and I want to see this one again. Adam, what do we see here?
I mean, beautiful thrown ball, and then Monty, I want to go higher. I want to go higher. I mean, beautiful catch. He had two Beavers around him as well.
Yeah, as he hits the dance after, too. Yeah. Almost looking like DeAndre Hopkins out there.
Yeah, seriously.
Now the momentum is all on the Duhawks' side.
Yep.
And looks like Booker's back there once again for the Beavers.
Yeah.
After just muffing the punt a couple minutes ago.
You know, for Booker, that's definitely, I mean, it's smart putting him back out there. You don't want to take him out after one mistake, obviously. It did allow Duhawks to score, but you can't kill the kid's confidence super quickly.
Especially with the freshman as well.
Absolutely.
Talmadge boots this one away, and it's not going to be Booker receiving it as the Beavers at the 15, at the 20, and that's all they're going to get as it was Dolan Poskel on the return. Pospachul, excuse me. First down on the Beaver Zone 20-yard line here. Herrera looking at the play. Hands off to Griffith after throwing the interception
right away.
Previous possession.
I think that was Doyle. That met him right away.
Big Sean Doyle, you see right there, number 35 for the Duhawks, the senior leader on this team. A junior leader, excuse me. Four receivers out wide, two on each side for the Beavers. Era. Quick drop back, rolls out to his right, looking to throw it to his man, and that one's incomplete.
No.
Looks like it was number 36, Brandon Phelps, on the coverage for the Duhawks.
I think Herrera just looking to air that one out to Banks.
Yep. You see on your screen right there, right in front of you, almost coming into your home, number 33, Rashad Johnson, checked in for the Duhawks. Three receivers at the bottom of your screen for the Beavers as Herrera drops back, throwing it deep. He's got a man over the middle, but he underthrew them, and it's intercepted. I believe, is it Zach Kemp with the interception? No, that was number 38, Josh Rydberg with the interception. And that ball, once again, just nowhere near the – he had a man open and just underthrew him. Maybe as you see the replay here, we can see what happens.
And pressure definitely probably in the mind of Herrera again, but just another underthrown ball.
Herrera's 10th interception of the year. As you see right there, Rydberg with the interception. Looks like England and Pritchett in the backfield. As Pritchett got another hole to run through.
Hole.
Gets around 15 yards there on the run as he hits him with the first down celebration.
Oh, line making it very easy for Pritchett and Bausch to have themselves a day.
That's only Pritchett's third run of the game as well, and he was already at, I believe, 44 yards, so he's pushing 80 yards, close to it now, as he loses a yard, maybe gets back to the line of scrimmage on the next play. Duhawks on the Beaver 31 yard line after back-to-back interceptions on back-to-back possessions. Three turnovers in a row for the Beavers, and that's something that Coach Mollering will not be happy with as England fakes the screen. He's going to Monty Brown, and Monty...
Oh, my gosh.
Monty Brown almost came down with that one over the defender, number 20, Cordell Johnson, who is 6'4". Monty listed as 6'2", and Johnson listed as 6'4", so freshman and sophomore both going at it there.
You know, I mean, that height difference might be it's a good amount.
Mm-hmm.
But, yeah, Cordell, definitely big dude. I mean, you can see it from, we can see it from up here. Just a big body.
England, three-step drop back. Going over the middle to Monty Brown, and that's got to be a flag. Yep. I don't know how the side judge didn't call, but the back judge threw the flag. And that was clearly pass interference, but you'd rather take the 15-yard penalty than a touchdown.
huge.
Absolutely, especially down 20-0 already.
I believe that was Cordell Johnson trying to cover Monty Brown. That's a tough task for anybody.
Extremely tough.
As Britt checks out and Crawford checks in. Brown and McGovern, the receivers at the bottom of your screen. McGovern lined up behind the offensive line. And then you got Haynes and Crawford at the top of your screen. England, dump pass to McGovern, and are they going to say fumble? They're going to say incomplete. Yeah, that was a forward pass. That forward pass not going anywhere, bringing up second down and 10 for the Duhawks on the Beavers' 16-yard line.
A little close one there.
That was very close. Six minutes and 12 seconds left to go here in this first half. Your Duhawks 28, Buena Vista 0. England drops back. Doesn't see anything, but he's got a lot of room.
Is he going to get in?
And he runs in for the touchdown. England with another touchdown. He can do it in the air or on ground, folks. He does it all. England does it all for the Duhawks, and, man, they found a good one in this sophomore.
Yeah, they really did. And, again, can't stress it enough. Dual threat. Got him for two more years.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, get excited, Duhawk fans. This kid.
Times are changing in Dubuque.
This kid is something special.
And Duhawks are 2-1 in conference, and knock on wood, hopefully it keeps going this way, and they advance to 3-1 for the first time in a very long time as Talmadge's kick is up, and it is good.
Right down main.
You see the replay here, and just the poise of England here. You can't speak on enough, can you, Adam?
No, not at all. I mean, just calm, cool, and collected. Props to that O-line, though.
Mm-hmm.
Like, just making it hard for that Beaver defensive front to get in there and allow England to have that big hole and then lots of open space to get to that end zone.
As you see, the offensive line, and like I was talking about, it's just a great block, and they've been great all day. And I'd assume maybe have the Duhawks starters finish off this half and then maybe a little bit into the third, and then I'd start seeing some of the
second guys.
Yeah, but it's a little harder for second string linemen to come in because you just don't have that many, especially at a Division III level.
Yeah, definitely. I wouldn't be surprised if that offense changed up a little bit and we see pretty much the same defense.
Talmadge's leg is going to start getting sore in this first half. He's going to need to go massage
it. Absolutely. A little heating pad on.
Another booming kick from Talmadge, and they're going to fair catch that one.
I mean, if you're that Beaver receiving core, the three back, you got to – I know that wind's making it hard for them to judge it. It's downwind.
Herrera in the backfield here with Griffith. Low snap, and Griffith gets lit up because of that. Duhawks defense just everywhere once again making plays.
Yeah, that defensive front not allowing this Beaver run game to get anything going.
Second and deep here. Beavers going backwards like they've been doing almost this whole game.
Definitely.
Herrera and Griffith backfield again. four receivers out wide. The handoff to Griffith, looking to make something happen on the outside. Gets past the original line of scrimmage, bringing up third and nine here. It looks like there's a Duhawk down on the play as well. I can't quite make out who it is. That's number 98 for the Duhawks. Emmett Finn. Just needs a little help up from the trainers here. He's able to walk off on his own power. Hopefully it's just a stinger. Griffith, same personnel as last snap. And you got Booker lined up as the tight end. They fake the handoff. Herrera pressured out. Nowhere to go. Oh, and that ball's a fumble.
It's loose.
But I believe that ball might have came out with a kick from a Duhawk defender or a hole. There's a lot of laundry on the field. Going to be holding. Duhawks are going to decline it. Oh, looks like it'll be fourth down and not a fumble. As McGovern will be back to kick, standing on the Beavers' 48-49 yard line.
Scary territory here for this Beaver punt team here.
I expect Coach Bauer to send a lot of people to try and block this. That's going to be a safety. Huge play for the Duhawks, and that is Joey Foley, the senior, getting the safety. Great play by Joey Foley, staying poised and getting the safety, and the woes just continue for this Beaver team, especially on special teams. To get a replay here, Adam, and walk us through this one here.
Again, like you said, just going to pressure that Beaver punt team and just a bad
routine
snap
tackle.
And routine tackle in the end zone. Muffed the ball.
Yeah.
Just
Duhawks
pretty simple there.
Get the ball here with 4:55 left to go in the half. Up 37-0. And the Duhawks will get the ball. After that safety as well. Your support of the Lord's cheerleading program. We're taking a while to get the special teams out here. As here comes out the special teams for the Beavers. Looks like Loris will send theirs out relatively quickly as well. Dwayne and Harrison, the two returnmen for the Duhawks. As the Beavers are going to be sending this one away from their own 20-yard line. Duhawks looking to even capitalize off of even more mistakes from the Beavers this possession, Adam.
Absolutely. Without the offenses rolling, you got to expect they're going to
do a little bit of a squib kick, and Duhawks going to fair catch that one and maybe trying to force a turnover there with that one, but that's because the Duhawks even better field position. Yeah.
Right, like the
it was Zach Redding here,
45 here.
Fair caught that one, yeah. Already putting the Duhawks in plus territory here. And I don't think this second quarter, at least the times that they've had the ball the last three possessions, this is the farthest they've been out in their past three possessions.
Yeah.
Because they've been around the 30 for the interceptions, and then on the muffed, they're at the 20.
Muffed, yeah.
Haven't seen them have to work that much for these last few touchdowns that they've had.
No, not at all. They hand this one off to Ty. Ty, it's possibly his biggest run of the game. About 5 yards. Looks like they're having some issues with the chains here. Chains are kind of leading me astray here. They just moved him down after the snap. Looks like it'll be second and six. England fakes the run to tie. Gets to McGovern. Oh. It's a trick play. McGovern airing out to Monty Brown. Oh, he had him if that ball stayed in bounds. They faked out the Beavers, and Monty beat his man one-on-one. Duhawk's getting a little tricky up 37 here early, and I got to say I like it.
I'm for it. I am for it.
Pretty good throw by McGovern as well.
Not a bad throw at all. Just a little left.
Just a little.
But
just a bit outside.
Yeah, just a wee bit. But yeah.
England alone in the backfield, five wide.
And they're probably England passing, right?
Quick drop back. He's got Jaheim Haynes wide open over the middle. Makes a man miss. Says, see ya. And gets a first down and then some on the Beaver 9 yard line. The chains are moving. The Duhawks trying to go hurry up as you see the replay here. Five wide, and England knew right away where he was throwing that ball and just hit a seam wide open and whoop, see ya. Jamal Britt behind England now as Britt actually motions to the slot spot, and Bausch moves into the backfield as little miscommunication here as the Duhawks are going to call a timeout. And Adam, the Duhawks are playing well in this first half, but there's always obviously room for improvement. What do you think they could improve on possibly?
Maybe a little bit towards like that run game, almost the first play run, the first run that they always do. That usually gets stopped at the line just a little bit, but I know that's always to get it going. But really, I mean, there really hasn't been much mistakes out of this Duhawks offense and even defense. Just some small things, small errors that they could have had, but don't really see it because of how the team is just performing.
And then what about for the Beavers now?
It's just the offense. The offense hasn't been able to do much. Defense.
Their defense gets put in those bad spots,
you could say. Yeah,
been on the field for a while.
Absolutely. It's constantly that defense. I know they're tired, and I'm sure that they're upset that they have to constantly be out there.
He's motion out wide to Monty Brown, who's wide open in the end zone for a touchdown.
Yeah.
He gets the 1 foot in,
looking dandy
while doing it.
Have yourself a day, young man.
As we talked about, there's that connection sophomore to sophomore. And
yeah.
Monty Brown, always a little bit of swagger to him, especially when he's playing this well. Just adds to it.
Yeah.
It's huge for the Duhawks, as maybe we'll start seeing some second stringers in this first half.
You would assume. And leading 43-0.
You would hope 44 after this kick. Scott's kick is up and
right down
the middle. We don't expect anything else from Scott besides this.
No.
As you see the replay here, and a little misdirection, motion of Monty around, and they probably lost him and all that. And
just a good thrown ball.
You always got to know where number five's at.
Yeah, absolutely. You always do.
And the Duhawks are having themselves a day. As there will be a ceremony at halftime for the women's track and field team as they continue their reign as one of, if not the best, D3 program in the nation.
Yeah, I mean, you're always talking about the Loras women's track team when it comes to the track season. I mean, just so many studs on that squad, throwing, running, jumping.
They're insane.
Yeah, they're
the work in, too.
They are so good.
Rain, snow, sun,
Oh, yeah. I mean, they're always you see him outside every day of the week.
Scott's back to kick it again. Kicks away, and it's a short one as they receive it at their 20-yard line at the 35 and brought down at around the Beavers' own 37-yard line.
It's got to be BV's best field position on their last five, six drives.
And the Duhawks was 44 points here. The highest they've scored in the game is 82, but I don't know if we'll be getting up to that point.
Yeah.
As Herrera in the backfield once again. Having a rough day so far, and the rough day is just starting to spread through the rest of the team as Blaine Jordan meets Griffith in the backfield. Says hello. I know we were talking pregame, Adam. We kind of expected this to be a little bit closer of a game, and because on paper the team seemed to stack up pretty well. What do you think has just been the X factor, the what's happened?
I mean, it's got to be the energy coming from the Duhawks, absolutely. Homecoming, so I mean they're already coming in excited and ready to play and put on a show for all the alum students. So I mean, it's just got to be that energy. It's just Duhawks started out on a high. So, yeah, I mean, that's just carried over throughout the game. And it's just kind of sucked the energy out of BV. Haven't really seen much from them, obviously, with the turnovers. And just the Duhawks just constantly scoring.
On that previous play, the Beavers picking up around 9-8 yards, making a third and two here for them as they look to pick up the first down. You start to hear crowd getting into it. Another low snap, looking for a screen play, and I believe that's Zach Kemp once again making the play and throwing him backwards, bringing him fourth down. They actually lost yards on that play. And that'll bring out the punt team once again for the Beavers. Man. That seems like a phrase we've been saying every fourth play for them.
Yeah.
It's been a while since they've moved the chains.
By Swinger definitely getting his work cut out for him today.
It's McGovern back to receive for the Duhawks again. The last punt attempt, remember, was that safety. This punt is away, and McGovern's telling him to get away from it as it takes a Beaver bounce and rolls past the Duhawk 20.
Like 17 or 18 line probably here.
The starters coming back out for the Duhawks. And Evan England is just having himself a day. As there you see one of the bigger crowds we've seen in the Rock Bowl in one of the broadcasts we've done. And
absolutely.
They're making some noise for sure.
Oh, definitely. I mean, how could you not?
Mm-hmm.
Your team's up 44-0. They're definitely helping this Duhawk team for sure.
As it's England and Bausch in the backfield. England, quick turn, gets it to Crawford. Good block there by Dwayne.
Yep.
The Duhawks are going to go hurry up here with a minute 28 and going as there's an injured, looks like a injured Beaver player down on the Duhawks sideline. And it might be number 20, Cordell Johnson, is the 6'4", 165 freshman Cordell Johnson, as he's able to walk off the field on his own power, the freshman from Houston, Texas. He starts to jog off now. Looks like he's not really moving that left shoulder, but you just don't like to speculate.
Yeah.
England getting it to Ty in the flat. Ty's got a blocker. And makes a man miss. Cool. And he picks up the first down. Ty almost like hurdled, high stepped over a guy and picked up that first down. Looked good while doing it.
Absolutely.
First and 10 for the Duhawks on their own 45-yard line. Play action. Dump it off to, I believe that's McGovern. Tries to do a spin move, make a man miss, and he just holds on to McGovern's ankle for dear life.
We are now just below that minute mark for the half. Duhawks sure want to score before they go into that half. Just keep adding on to that lead.
England and Bausch run this clock down. 34 seconds here. They hand it off to Ty, and Ty bounced it off, losing yard. Looks like Coach Helminiak is content with taking this 44-0 lead into half, as I'm sure every coach would be.
Oh, absolutely.
And Dukes won't have to run another play, as it looks like both teams are willing to wave the flag and end the half. As you hear this loyal Duhawk crowd start cheering on their team.
Yeah.
As you see the players trying to get them hyped, running off. As there you see Evan England, the leader of this offensive team. And at the end of this half, your Lordstown Duhawks 44, Beavers 0. And Adam, what are you looking for both teams, I should say, in the second half to make adjustments?
For the Duhawks, you know, just keep going. Just keep rolling. There's no need to really change much. I mean, you're up 44-0. Defense, offense are both doing outstanding job right now. For the Beavers, obviously, you want to see more production from their offense and just not put their defense in such hard spots like we saw multiple times, allowing Duhawks to start in their red zone and just a lot of turnovers from that offense.
Yeah, and like we said, end of the half, but stick around as there will be some ceremonies going on at halftime, and we'll pick back up with you after them. Hello and welcome back to the second half, where the Dewhawks are up 44-0. And as you saw, if you stuck around, a couple ceremonies for Hall of Famers, as well as the women's national champion track team as they just continue their reign. And what are some of the stats we got for this first half, Adam?
Well, obviously, we'll start with the score. Dewhawks leading 44-0 after the first half. Just impressive all around, both offensively and defensively. A couple player stats. I mean, you got to look at Evan England. He is 16 of 23, 194 yards, 3 touchdowns. His longest was 38 yards. He's only been sacked once. Props to that O-line. That's huge. Only him having him taken down once. There's been pressure, but nothing too bad. Ty Bausch, about 66 yards, longest being 26. Averaging about 4.9, and then Pritchett, his longest 43, averaging about 15 yards a carry.
61 total yards.
Yeah.
So. Killian's having himself a game, excuse me.
Yeah, I mean, and then just for the Beaver side, a lot of turnovers. We've seen 2 interceptions, muffed kickoff that ended up being covered by the Dewhawks, and then a safety. So hopefully Coach Mulroney got something going in the locker room for them. We know the Dewhawks probably going to be riding high after that very, very good first half. So let's hope for a good second half here. I'm sure we'll see some of the second stringers for that for this Dewhawk squad.
Yeah, and like you said, England, 194 yards passing. The leading receiver, Jamal Britt, a running back with 56 yards, and Marley Brown right behind him, 34. So, and only 4 receivers. Not 4, excuse me, the top 4, have 56 yards, 34 yards, 25, and 19.
Yeah.
Nobody's having really one big game, but he's really spreading around, and the run game has been going well for the Dewhawks as well.
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, passing, he's just spacing it out, letting everyone get touches.
4 total touchdowns, 3 in the air, then 1 rushing.
Yeah. Very, very impressive game for England today.
Maybe going for a conference player of the week or something.
Gotta be.
As Scott is back to kick away to start off the second half. 3 back for Buena Vista. Scott boots this one away. The win in his favor as that one's going to bounce back to the end zone for a touchback. Scott continues to be kicking well on these kickoffs. A good leg, especially with the wind at his back.
Yeah.
Looks like it's Herrera back out there after a rough, first half where we all saw him throw 2 interceptions and get sacked 1 time.
Yeah.
Have yet to break that 100-yard passing threshold as well, sitting at 71.
Yeah, sitting at 8 of 17. On the day for him, so yeah, definitely.
As the Dewhawks say, they have the ball, but Griffiths was more than down, I would say, when that ball came out. You like Dirts? The big nose tackle making the play there. Herrera, quick drop back, getting out of his hands quick. Finds a freshman. In that. 2 Dewhawks sandwich him right there. Jeremiah Powell, unable to go anywhere after the catch. Bring up 3rd and 4. Beavers on their own 31, a 3rd down here early. Will their offensive struggles carry into this second half? Guess we'll find out right here.
Yeah.
Herrera, another quick drop back. Designed rollout to the right. He's got his man for a 1st down. That is number 15, Dylan Laughlin. Designed QB bootleg out to the right. Herrera did a good job making, I believe it was Blaine Jordan, miss on the sack as there's a Dewhawk player down on the sideline. You see still a pretty big crowd here. You see the students on this homecoming. As the Duhawk player is still down on that sideline, we can't quite make out who it is. Zach Kemp.
Up and jogging off on his own power. Definitely positive with that. The negative being that it's Zach Kemp down.
Yeah, Zach Kemp has been everywhere for the Duhawks.
Yep.
Three tackles and one tackle for a loss, so he's just been everywhere. Dawson Charlie is actually leading the Duhawks in tackles. That's Herrera getting out of his hands quick over Joey Foley, and that'll be a flag.
Be a flag.
Yeah, Joey.
Yeah.
Kind of got beat on a double move and held him there. So we get the official call from our official. Automatic first down spot of the foul for the pass interference on Foley. Who had a pretty good last week against Warper, coming down with two interceptions.
Yeah.
That was maybe one of the lone bright spots the Duhawks had. And that 42-3 loss at number 21 Warper. Different story here today as the Duhawks are just rolling over the Beavers, however.
It just looks like a whole new team.
It's definitely something that homecoming's definitely got to play a factor into. And maybe, you know, temperature's starting to change. It's starting to get more into football weather. A little chillier with some breeze. And I'm sure that's something all these guys love.
Oh, absolutely.
Mason Griffith with the carry, tackle made by number 95, Blaine Jordan.
Blaine Jordan, the senior, making the tackle on that previous play. That got about 3 yards. Has Herrera and Griffith alone in the backfield together. Herrera, quick drop back once again. We've seen that a lot. Incomplete as that one just bounced off Laughlin's hands, let it go through his hands, and hit off that right shoulder pad.
Seen some better balls out of Herrera. That one, obviously, a little over the top, but not as many underthrown ones so far in this first drive from him.
Be interesting if they go to the backup freshman, Seth Gallardo, maybe down 44, and see what he can do, see if we can get him on the board. Herrera throwing deep, got a man wide open. Coverage. That's Booker, I believe. Excuse me, Powell. Getting it down to the Duhawks. Looks like 7 yard line.
Yeah. Had to have been a little miscommunication there from that Duhawks secondary. Cause, I mean,
you saw Jace Gwynn flying to him after he was already by him.
Yeah. I mean, just wide open. I feel like really the first mistake we've seen out of this Duhawk team, offense and defensively. Maybe BV get some life back in them here. They can get in the end zone.
Yeah, three receivers out to the right of your screen, one at the bottom. That's Powell at the bottom of your screen who just made that big catch. So they hand it off to Griffith. Nowhere to go. And I believe that's Blaine Jordan once again. Oh, Josh Kiefer, excuse me.
I haven't said his name much.
He's been kept under wraps pretty well today. But something he always talks about is doing your 1-of-11 job. And if everybody does that, then the team just defense runs smoothly. And that's something he's a big, big praiser of. Same personnel for the Beavers. Herrera, quick drop, going for the fade in the end zone.
Oh,
intercepted by Foley as he toe taps down the sideline, and that'll put the Duhawks at the 10-yard line. Joey Foley having himself a day, a safety and an interception. That ball was just what went wrong there, Adam, as you see the replay here.
just a, I mean, another underthrown ball. Yeah, pretty much it. But just great coverage from Foley. But yeah, underthrown from Herrera. Beautiful toe tap, giving Foley his fourth INT on the year. Depending on what the rest of the conference is, that should put him at number one with interceptions. He came in tied for first with five other defensive men.
As Bausch has a lane here. And just
good run.
Excuse me, as Bausch had a big run there. Picking up a first down for the Duhawks, and Ty, like we said earlier, starting to get some life here in the second half as he's a volume back. As England hands off to Ty again. This one.
This time she's going to get met.
Yeah, this one much less successful than the previous one.
Redinger in the back in that tight end as Bausch motions to the left. They hand it off to Ty again. Ty's got some blocks. Redinger with a good block as Ty cuts back up the middle. And looks like chains will be moving. The Duhawks a first down. Ty's had a good drive as he's going to get a breather here as Britt checks in for him. Britt with the handoff, met immediately.
Wow.
Nowhere to go.
Good defensive play there.
With Ben Bogman, number 53, left guard, didn't look overly happy after that play with either a teammate or himself.
Yeah. Airing it out. Oh, McGovern wide open. Oh.
As there goes McGovern down the sideline. As the Duhawks stay hot, and Evan England, that'll put him over 200 yards passing today. As he's one of the best quarterbacks in the conference when it comes to playing at home passing.
Absolutely.
Well, the first home game against Nebraska Wesleyan, he was over the 300 mark.
Yeah.
Now he's at 200. He has to have a pretty big quarter here, I'd say, to get himself over it, because I don't know how much more he'll be
absolutely
playing if they score here after this drive. England, another drop back, looking over the middle to Britt, and that one for the first down. Jamal Britt looks like he'll be leading receiver once again today for the Duhawks, as that reception will put him close to 75 yards on the day. As Ty checks back in for Britt. As you can, I'm sure you folks at home can hear the wind pushing our papers around up top. That can only give you what it's like down on the field as they hand it off to Ty. And on first and goal, goes nowhere.
Met immediately at that line.
It's actually going to go down as a loss on the play for the Duhawks. Getting them second and goal from the Beaver 11. England fakes the handoff to Ty. Oh, that one knocked incomplete. Looking for his man, Monty Brown.
Good deflection from Woodward there. The 6'1 sophomore linebacker for the Beavers.
As on this third down and goal from the 11, the Ducks going to elect to take out the tight end Redinger and put in another receiver. They got four of them out there. Haynes, McGovern, Crawford, and Brown. Brown at the top of your screen. Keep an eye out for him on this play. England looking to the right side of the field. Has to pivot around. Looks like he's going to try and score it on his own. He's going to be just short.
Just short.
Putting his body on the line there as he took a pretty big hit on that sideline as he's a little slow to get up.
Shaking up.
I don't know if that's something that you want to see your quarterback taking a hit that hard when they're up
44 to nothing.
Yeah, probably not, I would say, especially with how good he is and how big of a factor he is for this DuHawk offense. A little scary when you see him slow to get up.
Yeah, as this brings up a fourth down for the DuHawks. Ty Bausch, we're in the Wildcat. Evan England out wide. Monty Brown motioned over. Ty is going to keep it as long as Jamal Britt pancakes a man. And Ty gets in there for the touchdown. As Jamal Britt absolutely pancaked a guy and gave good room for Ty to run through there. As there you see Jamal Britt, number 44. Almost was a fullback that play.
Yep.
And that drive was just majority of Ty Bausch and a couple deep passes from England.
Yep.
As Talmadge out to kick once again. His kick is up and good.
Right down main. Take a quick look at that replay just from that beautiful touchdown. Like you said, unbelievable pancake block there from Britt, allowing Ty just to reach in and get a pretty easy touchdown.
Yeah. Showing his athleticism, too, as well, jumping around all those guys. There you see the offensive line has been doing well today. Number 71, Sean Corgelis, the anchor on that left side.
Yeah.
So we got a little AC/DC here before Scott kicks it away. Three turners back. Once again for the Beavers, looks like Andre Booker, if you remember from the first half, had a hit off his face mask. Is not back there to return for the Beavers. As the Beavers are going to elect a fair catch this one. Oh, I lied. They thought it was going to bounce in, but now they got to return. They're in a bad spot, and looks like the official's going to say that one. Looks like they're going to have a discussion here. And then I'll tell you what I think, because I'm not an official and I don't know.
I'm not entirely sure.
I don't really know what's going on right now. There you see the officials talking. I think they're saying it's either going to be at the one. I think they're going to say it's at the one because they went for the fair catch. And that's where they picked it up at. As they're reading out the 50-50 raffle winner right now. Look for the. What do you think the Duhawks would do here, Adam, with the Beavers pushed up in their own end zone?
I mean, we've talked about the young line. Mm-hmm. You got to assume they're going to send just a good amount of force right at Herrera, especially with the rough day that he's having so far. Definitely put some pressure on. Maybe get a second safety today.
There's going to be a pass, and it was a little bit of a push-off there from the Beaver receiver, Laughlin, number 15, on Foley, and that's what he's talking to the ref about. And that was more than a little bit of extension that the refs usually like. Well, that was a full-on push-off that gave him about 3 yards of separation. Second and 10 here for the Beavers on their own 1 yard line. As they get the play relayed into them. Herrera hands this one off to Griffith. Griffith gets some more breathing room. Getting around 2 yards there. And sometimes in a blowout, how big of a factor do you think this will be today, Adam, is keeping everybody locked in mentally for the team and just still trying to get better as well as that. Do you think that could possibly relay an issue for the DuHawks here?
Yes and no. I feel like with how experienced this team is, they'll know not to get too high of themselves and stay locked in for next week.
as there goes the Beavers. Bring it up to, looks like it'll be downed at their own 28-yard line. Possible call on the catch. Another freshman for the Beavers. So you see that young offensive line that we've talked about for the Beavers right there on your screen. Herrera's trying to get the receivers lined up properly on this first down play. Herrera dropping back. Thought about throwing it deep. Checks down to outright, and looks like it's Mason Morris on the tackle. But you can kind of tell right away Herrera was looking downfield and smartly checked down to the wide receiver.
Yeah.
Beavers on their own 34-yard line now. It's like second and five here. Herrera pressured out wide. Throws a popsicle. Makes a man miss, and another one. And now he's down the sideline. Can any Duhok catch up to him? And a shoestring and touchdown-saving tackle by, looks like Zach Kemp maybe?
Yeah, I think it was.
It looks like the Beavers are kind of trying to get a little hurry up here.
Beavers with a little life in them right now.
Yeah, and it's been possible call that's been doing it for him as well as he caught that first down and he got that one as well. So he's having a big drive here. Duhawks with six in the box. They're going to hand it off to Griffith as he breaks a couple tackles from the Duhawks and pushes forward for close to 5 yards.
We haven't really seen much of that. Usually that front line is very good about getting a good tackle right at that front.
Same personnel in here for the Beavers. On the second and short, they like to play action as that ball is intercepted once again. Herrera's rough day is happening once again as Joey Foley gets his second. As you see him counting there how many interceptions he has, and it's five. As you see right here, the replay, and what did Herrera do wrong here, Adam?
He just panicked. And pretty much threw it right to Foley. He didn't really have much options, and pressure got to him. He just kind of flipped it, threw it away, and just allowed Foley to get his fifth interception on the year.
Back-to-back weeks that Foley has had two interceptions in a game. As England is going to hand this one off to Bausch. Bausch bouncing it outside. Great vision there by Bausch to pick up the first down.
Great run from Bausch.
It was a good run of around 11 yards. Good run for Ty that last play, and he's had himself a heck of a third quarter. As he motions out left, lines up as wide receiver. As England, he's got Dwayne in. Threw that one just a little behind him. I think Dwayne was just so open there that England kind of panicked with how open he was down the seam.
Got a little too excited on that one.
England trying to get everybody situated here. 16 on the play clock.
He hands it off to Bausch once again. And Ty is just running over them all.
Mm.
Getting a first down and then some. Looking like a run of around 15 yards there.
Yeah.
Ty picking up another first down for the Dewhawks. Just keeps those chains right on moving.
Yeah, he does.
Ty gets it again. Bounce it to the outside, and these Beaver defenders starting to look a little more tired.
Yeah, definitely. Just allowing Bausch to run all over them right now. It's been all Bausch this drive.
Mm-hmm. Second down for the Dewhawks. They're starting to approach onto the Beavers' territory. Fake the handoff. And it's got Harrison Willis over the middle for a first down. As the Dewhawks are now into enemy territory as they're on the Beavers' 36-yard line. And Beavers are going to call a timeout here as the Dewhawks want a little hurry up.
More timeout call there by the Beavers. Like you said, Bausch just running all over them. Definitely got to be wearing them out a little bit with how quickly this offense goes. That's one thing you've probably noticed how much this offense likes to go. They just go, go, go.
As you see the crowd once again, one of the bigger crowds that we've seen in our time here at Loras.
Yep.
But homecoming always gets a good crowd.
Absolutely.
.303 left to go here in this third quarter. Your Dewhawks 51, Buena Vista Beavers nothing. And the scoreboard really says it all, Adam. I think there's much to anything else that we could possibly give the crowd.
Yeah, no, you're definitely right. Been all Dewhawks today.
There you see the scoreboard. Central's winning 14-13 in their fourth quarter game, who the Dewhawks beat, as you'll remember, on September 17th at Central. So as England throwing it here over the middle, he's got Harrison Willis
again.
Who takes a big hit but stays on his feet. I almost didn't know if he went down there for a second. I thought he might have stayed on his feet.
Yeah, seriously.
Harrison's having himself a game as well. He's really come alive in this second half.
Yep.
As Ty checks out of the game, getting a well-deserved rest. They've been leaning on him heavily this drive.
Definitely.
England and Britt, the two sophomores in the backfield on your screen. England keeps on a QB option as he slides and... looks like there's going to be no flag on that play.
Again, Dewhawks just on go mode right now.
Definitely not allowing the Beavers to get any of those fresh substitutions in,
nope.
Keeping them tired out there. Maybe possibly look for, I believe, Monty Brown's receiver at the top of your screen. Oh, it's Dwayne, and they're going up for Dwayne.
Oh.
That one incomplete. Going right by the social media for the sports page. Nick Hauser tossed that one back in for the Dewhawks. As Monty Brown has checked in for this 3rd and 9 here. As the Dewhawks are on the Beaver 15-yard line in the red zone once again today. And in the red zone, the Dewhawks have been 3-for-3 so far. All touchdowns. Let's see if they can go 4-for-4 here. Or at least pick up the first. As England is looking to Monty Brown's way. Doesn't like it. Nowhere
scrambling.
Open. Scrambling out of the pocket. Throwing it right to Jaheim Hayes for the touchdown. And like we've talked about, Evan England's poise in the pocket.
Oh.
And time he can buy it just allows for the team to get
sweet.
Open and make those plays.
Sweet, sassy, molassy. What a beautiful, beautiful toss from England to Haynes.
Yeah, and that play is not as easy as Evan made it seem.
No, not at all.
Having to run around and make that throw on the run in between a tight window between two Beaver defenders, and that's just beautiful.
Yeah, and then props to Jaheim to get open, make it easy for England to find him.
Big Sean had to run out late there. Need an extra blocker for the kick. Scott's kick is up and good once again.
I mean, you got to assume. Coach H is going to take England here soon.
I'd assume England's day is virtually over. That is his fourth touchdown of the game as well.
Have a day, youngin. Have a day.
As both special teams are out there now for Scott to kick this one away. Three Beavers standing on their own 10-yard line here. The wind's starting to pick up at the back of the Dewhawks. And Scott kicks one away. They're going to fair catch this one. Bring it out to the 25 for the Beavers.
Kickoff by Scott Selvage. Fair catch by Buena Vista. First down for the Beavers at the 25-yard line.
Looks like Beavers have switched quarterbacks, as looks like number two, Seth Gallardo, has checked into the game. And right away, mishandles the snap, and that's a fumble.
It's loose.
And it looks like, they're going to say he was down. And I don't know.
Interesting.
I don't know about that one.
Interesting.
I don't know if that is an interesting call by the official, but it would have... It would have saved a touchdown was number 18, Tim Harrington, a sophomore who would have returned that one back. As you see right there, number 6, Zacchaeus Knighton, has checked in to the game as well. Gallardo getting out quick. He got almost back to the original line of scrimmage, Zacchaeus Knighton on coverage there. That one was to Calvin Snell, a freshman. Third down here for the Beavers. Third and 11 to be exact. A big drop back here, looking to throw it deep. He's got a man. That ball's a little underthrown. That ball's knocked incomplete by the Dewhawks. That was number 33 on the coverage, Rashad Johnson, the junior from Tampa, Florida. You see the play here. Gallardo having to do a drop back, just had enough time to get it away and just thrown into the wind. Probably killed that ball a little bit.
Yeah, that's got to be tough for him. We mentioned the kickers having to kick into it. You got to definitely factor in that the quarterback's got to throw right into it. And it is still moving pretty good.
So that punt is almost blocked by Foley, and it's not a good
one
at all.
Not a good one.
As Beaver almost kicked it forward. And you can hear people saying that the line judge needs to move up more.
Yeah.
Looks like he's going to hold his spot. And as Bauer and Hominiak are both talking to him.
Yeah, the way they're mentioning it, it's like the refs didn't even realize it hit him.
Was a hold at the official call, and then Hominiak declined it. Because obviously you don't want to need to replay the down.
No.
So chains are getting set up here for this first and 10. So Duhawks are already in Beaver territory. They hand this one off. Going nowhere. As that was Johnny Kaysen the second. Going nowhere on that one. Bringing up second and long here for the Duhawks. Brown and Emulis, receivers in the game, as well as Harrison Willis. There's a little misdirection here. England throwing it deep to Monty Brown in double coverage. That one's intercepted. Intercepted by the Beavers. That's number one, B.J. Glover, a sophomore. And, yeah, just threw that one into triple coverage, yeah. England did, and it'll kind of put a damper on his good day.
Yeah, really the first and biggest mistake that we've seen from this offense and from England especially.
That's maybe trying to force it to Monty a little too much there. Gallardo in the backfield. They hand this one off for a good gain on first down around 4 yards. As that was number 28, Mevin Obregon on the carry to end the half from Surprise, Arizona. And at the end of the fourth quarter, your Loras Duhawks 58, Buena Vista Beavers nothing. Third quarter, excuse me, Buena Vista Beavers nothing. And Adam, in this fourth quarter, what do you think some of the keys will be for the Duhawks to hopefully not give up any points here and get that shutout?
Just let their defense, especially if we're bringing in those backups, those second string guys, obviously keep them out of the end zone, but keep that same energy those first guys have. I'm sure that they'll be on the sideline definitely hyping them up and everything, making sure that energy stays. For the Duhawks, you definitely want to try to keep them off the board, keep them at that nice goose egg.
Yeah, and Joey Foley's second two-interception game ties him for third in school history for interceptions in a game, putting him at two and putting him in third place, excuse me. And with his fifth interception of the year, it also ties him for second in a single season in interception. So he's having a good, great season.
Yeah, absolutely.
Gallardo, low snap once again from the Beavers. We've seen that a lot today. That pass is incomplete through the hands of the intended receiver. Look at that, Booker. Oh, no, excuse me, that was number 11, Qualen Edwards. Third down here for the Beavers. Almost going to have to be a pass here. As he gets a three-step drop back. He's got a man over the middle. A little bit of a lollipop, but they're going to come down with that.
Wow.
That's number 88, Dylan Eshelman. With the catch. And that ball hung up in the air for a while. Good concentration to stick with it and come down with it. You see the previous play right here. Just good concentration to come down with that ball, not let it hit the ground and come out.
Yeah, and Zacchaeus Knight, and just getting beat off the line, and then the height difference
definitely a factor in that. Mm-hmm. I mean, Zah only sitting at 5'9", whereas we've got Eshelman, who is 6'6". Definitely a good height difference there, so that definitely gives Eshelman an advantage with Knighton on him.
Yeah, Knighton is also not the biggest guy either as well.
No, not at all.
Second down here for the Beavers as the Duhawks bite on the play action with a mean juke from Gallardo. And I'll give him a first down as the Beaver bench finally has something to cheer about over there.
Seriously.
Gallardo trying to get Beavers on the board here and give them something to go home happy about. Dropping back. A lot of time. Going deep.
Yeah.
Overthrew his man. Once again, going for Eshelman.
Yeah, Gallardo, you can definitely see he put a lot behind that one.
Mm-hmm. Especially with the wind at his back. Could have caused the overthrow as well. Just had a cyclone come through the booth real quick. Dropping back another screen pass, and he's just lit up right away, not even able to catch the ball. A great play by the Duhawks, number 51, Michael Carney, the sophomore. Third and 10 here for the Beavers. It'll be interesting to see what they do here if they don't get it. Three receivers out wide at the bottom of your screen. Gallard dropping back. Oh, looking to throw it again, and that one's intercepted by the Duhawks. That is number 18, Tim Harrington. The sophomore from Pearl City, Illinois. And just high-pointed that ball.
Yeah.
And with Gallardo getting hit on that one as well, it definitely affected it, and you'll be able to see it right here.
Yeah, Gallardo gets hit hard from behind and just, like you said, high point. I'll take that.
Gallardo's hit by number 21. No, not Ty Bausch. Owen Kelly. The sophomore from Chicago, Illinois, in St. Rita High School. As Hutchinson, the junior, is checked in. So he hands this one off to Johnny, who goes nowhere. Garrett Hutchinson, second-string quarterback out of Des Moines, Iowa, and went to Roosevelt High School. Listed at 5'11", 205, and coming in to this year with a Devin Moore question mark. There's a QB battle between England and Hutchinson. People said they were both looking good, but inevitably went with England as Kaysen's run here is close to the original line of scrimmage, bringing up third and probably 11 here.
Yep.
The Duhawks receivers are Harrison, DeWayne, and Michael Crawford.
Yeah, I mean, with England also off as well. It'll be interesting to see how much we see Monty go back out on the field as well.
It looks like Monty's day's done as well with him and England standing next to each other over there on the sideline. As Hutchinson's going to drop back, dump it off short to Harrison, who stays on his feet but brought down the second attempt. Got around 4 yards there for the Duhawks, and they'll bring out the punt team a quick three and out. Driscoll still doing the punt for the Duhawks. Been a while since we've seen him out there, however.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, with how good the offense has been and even the defense scoring quite a bit as well, we really haven't seen much of Driscoll.
That punt is away, and it's a good one. As Beaver's going to fair catch it. And, ooh.
little questionable catch there. But nonetheless, they got it, and it was looked like that was number 82, Isaiah Mornes on the return there. And Beavers will start from their own 26-yard line. Gallardo in the backfield with, it looks like, Obregon as they hand it off to him. And
yeah, he's
nowhere once again.
Stuffed right at the line.
Beaver's trying to get something going here and trying not to lose their fifth straight meeting with the Dewhawks, which would give the Dewhawks a 10-win and 14-loss in this series since 1997, as that ball is incomplete as the receiver fell for the Beavers. The intended target there was to Blake Pagel from Rockwell City.
Yeah, and it almost looked like Pagel just kind of just slipped a little bit,
mm-hmm.
making that pass from Gallardo just go over his head and out of bounds.
And what we've seen from Gallardo's when he's thrown is he really winds up into it and tries to get his whole body into it, as that one is going to be a loss for the Beavers, bringing up fourth down and long, and out comes the punt team. And that was number 51 for the Dewhawks, Michael Carney.
Yeah, you,
second time we've said his name already, making plays.
Yeah, and back to Gallardo, you mentioned he kind of just puts a lot of effort into it. I mean, freshman, only 5'9", 170, so I mean, that you got to, not necessarily big dude, not the biggest frame for quarterback, but props to him being out there as well.
Another punt for the Beavers. It's possibly their best one of the day as McGovern riskingly picks that one up and gets hit right away.
Bold move out of Marty there.
So we're going to get a second look at Garrett Hutchinson behind center. Number 89 for the Jewhawks is Drew Randall, who you saw right there, the freshman at the bottom of your screen. Pritchett in the backfield, as well as it looks like Edwards, as they hand it off to Pritchett, who's got more room to run. And his good day continues as well.
Yeah. Great day for Pritchett.
KP having himself a day. And looks like number 28, Edward Williams. Gus, the bus has checked into the game.
The bus.
KP with another handoff here. Shoulder pad showing, doesn't matter to him. As he picks up the first down and bounces right back up as a, looks like a Dewhawk lineman is down. Looks like it's number 54 for the Dewhawks.
Yeah, Tyson Smith.
He's able to get back up, and so he'll be able to play this down and the rest of his possession, hopefully, first and 10 here. Pritchett in the backfield once again. Why not keep giving
right
it to him?
Middle. Yeah.
Picks up around 4 or 5 yards there. Yeah, it's 61 going into this quarter. I assume Ty's day is done with right around 138 yards rushing total.
Yeah.
Pritchard with another handoff here. Keep those legs turning. Close to that first down marker, bringing up third, and it'll be definitely third and manageable here. The Dewhawks are now on the Beavers' side of the field once again.
Yeah, after that third quarter, Dewhawks were 6-10.
Mm-hmm.
Third down conversions, not a bad percentage at all.
much better than their season average coming into this game, which was right around the 45% mark.
Yeah.
As Pritchett is exhausted on the sidelines, he sits down and puts his arms on the bench. Johnny back in. Garrett's going to throw it on third down to DeWayne, who'll pick up the first down.
Just a smooth, fluid throw there from Hutch.
Mm-hmm. Hutchinson getting a play call in here. Kaysen in the backfield. Going to fake the handoff to him. Let Hutchinson air it out. Why not? He's got a man wide open. And that'll be a touchdown for the Duhawks. What a throw by Hutchinson to Drew Randall. That was a great throw, great play design by the Duhawks.
Cassie Malassie.
Wide open. He would have had to, I don't know what would have had to happen for him to drop that, but that was right in the bread basket. That was a perfectly placed ball.
What a beautiful toss there from Hutch. Yeah, and the sidelines are loving it right now.
First collegiate touchdown for Randall. That's Talmadge's kick. Is up, and it is good.
Down main.
Giving the Duhawks a 65-0 lead with 7:43 left to go in the game. As we take a look at that last play. Good sell on the play action on first and 10, and why not take a shot?
Right. I mean, just a perfectly thrown ball from Hutch. Mm-hmm. Like you said, a lot would have had to gone wrong for that not to end up as a touchdown.
Mm-hmm. Michael Malone, number 37, was the one on the coverage there for the Beavers. Wartburg is currently beating Central 28-14. If you remember earlier, it was 14-13. And Central is up, so Central has yet to score since that point.
Again, we mentioned it talking about the Duhawk loss to Wartburg, but Wartburg just a very, very good team.
Possibly the best team in the conference.
Absolutely, absolutely.
As the Duhawks will move to 3-1 in conference and 3-3 overall. And the Beavers have moved to 1-3 and 2-4 overall after this game. Scott's kick is up and away, and the wind kind of died down for that kick.
Yep.
Or at least it's not getting to the field, as you see the flag post not moving up top.
Yeah, not nearly as much as it was in that first half and even the early stages of that third quarter. Yeah, I don't know about you, Hugh, but I mean, 65-0 was not,
that's not what I was expecting at all
coming into this game. Well, I thought it was going to be neck and neck.
I thought it was going to be, a close game. And
much closer.
On paper, doing our research for all this, and it just it seemed like they were pretty equal teams.
Yeah.
He's like, Ardo's going to keep this one and roll out to his left. Oh, throws a strike to his man for a catch, and that's number 8 for the Beavers, Nico Flores. Oh, excuse me, that was Caden Kolthoff. Two number 8s. Nico's on defense.
I mean, just a good place ball there from Gallardo. Mm-hmm.
Killian Edwards is also in for the Beavers, that receiver, number 11. They're going to hand this one off. Got a lot of green grass to roam and brought down by nice open field tackle by, looks like that's number 9 for the Duhawks, Cormac Flynn. Freshman from Monmouth, Illinois. As now you'll see a lot of sophomores and freshmen checking in for the Duhawks the rest of the way.
I mean, why wouldn't you?
Well, yeah, why not? Homecoming. They run again and still nowhere to run for the Beavers like it's been all day.
Damn.
Bring up fourth down and short. Or it'll be fourth down and longer after losing yards on that play.
Stop was made by number 56, Jonah Clark. No gain on the play.
So Beavers are struggling to get their personnel lined up correctly. Yep. Third and about 2 yards here for the Beavers.
Gotta get this off. Yeah,
it's going to be a timeout. Force their run down and play clock. Yeah. There's about 4 or 5 seconds left.
Just getting ready to say they got to get this bad boy snapped.
And if you weren't able to hear that, the women and men are both at Simpson College playing soccer today, and the women just won 3-0 over Simpson. You know, they're not necessarily having the year they'd like to have, the women, but as long as you win the games and win conference and get into that tournament, anything can happen.
Yeah, you know, that should move them to 9-0-3. The three draws, I mean, last year only one.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, the three definitely was a little concerning at the beginning of the year when they tied two pretty early, but I mean they're so good.
Yeah, they are.
Where it's not even like a, didn't even faze them really.
And the women's tennis team also won their first of two matches today, 9-0. So they have a doubleheader, and their second one being in Indianola. Luke Olsad with the stop there for the Duhawks after the first down. For the Beavers, giving them some new life here, moving the chains. They fake the handoff. Pass is incomplete. Looks like there's going to be a flag on the play. That looked a little tic-tacky as Calvin Snell was the intended receiver. And they're going to call that one on number 21, Owen Kelly.
Mm.
Coach Bauer's not happy with the official after that one.
Yeah.
You see Kelly right there on your screen. It was a little bit of a weak call, especially with the scores. Obviously, that shouldn't affect the rest of mine, but they weren't calling that earlier in the game. I was just kind of surprised to see a flag come out there. Gallardo, quick drop back. Another short pass. That one will be completed. This looks like that was Jacob Sanchez on the coverage for the Duhawks as there's another Duhawk athlete down. You see the crowd's kind of thinned out a little bit. Still a good amount of people here. As that was number 27 for the Duhawks, Jacob Quando, senior. Bring up second down and 6 here for the Beavers. Bunch set on both sides here. Duhawks filling the box. It'll be a pitch to the left. Trying to make man miss. I'll bring up third down. Third and inches for the Beavers on the Duhawk 26-yard line. So you hear the fans wanting that shutout from the defense, as that'd be huge for homecoming, and just winning on homecoming is big, but a shutout would be even better as the Beavers pick up a first down here and get closer to that prized end zone. Obregon on the carry for the Beavers. So he's been a man the majority of this second half for the Beavers. Yep. Gallardo
Shotgun formation. They're going to hand this one off again. The run game's starting to open up a little bit for the Beavers in this fourth quarter. Yeah. Jack Deegan with the tackle. Swinging down here. Beavers looking to get on that scoreboard. Gallardo getting out of his hands quick. And wow, there's a lot of contact there.
A lot of contact there from
Zacchaeus Knighton. Snell was the intended receiver on that play.
Almost surprised there wasn't anything there.
Yeah, the officials let him get away with a lot there compared to the previous pass interference call. Third down here for the Beavers. Duhok defense looking to make a stop and hold him to a field goal. Gallardo trying to get off in the flat. Almost batted down by the Duhawks. As number 58 for the Duhawks making the tackle. That'll be Luke Volstad. Bringing up fourth down, and obviously the Beavers are going to go for it. A field goal doesn't really do you much here.
No.
As the crowd starting to get into it. Some of the loudest they've been all day.
Yeah, seriously, they really want this shutout.
As they're going to try and pick up the first down at least, and they do. That was a good hit there. But Snell has been Gallardo's go-to man. And definitely that freshman-to-freshman, possibly roommates there.
Yeah.
Getting the way he's been looking at him the whole time they've been in. And coming into this fourth quarter, the Duhawks did not have anybody over 100 yards receiving. Monty only had 34 yards, and Jamal Britt had 72 coming into this fourth quarter. They go for a slip screen. That one wouldn't quite develop as they dropped it. Marty McGovern was second for the Duhawks with 55 yards, and Harrison Willis had 51, putting him at third on the Duhawks receiving. And the leading receiver of the whole game actually coming into this quarter was number 7 for the Beavers, Dolan Pospical, with 75 yards, just outreaching Britt by 3. Gallardo designed rollout to the left, throwing it up, and there's nobody there, which will bring up a tough play here for these Beavers. Third and goal for the Beavers from the Duhawk 8-yard line. Gallardo jumping back. Ducks down from a hit as he throws it in that wall.
Wow.
Just goes through the hands of the receiver. That was number 8. Caden Kolthoff, the intended receiver. They're going to go for it here on fourth down.
Owen Kelly yet again putting the pressure on Gallardo.
2 minutes left in the game as the Duhawks look to seal that shutout on homecoming from their own 8-yard line. Hear the crowd getting into it once again. Willing that shutout. Beavers from the Duhawks 8-yard line. Looking to get up early. No good. He's pressured on the throw. That'll inevitably cause a Duhawks shutout. It looked like number 58 for the Duhawks applied the pressure there. Luke Bolstad, the senior from South Beloit, Illinois. Minute 56 left to go here in the game.
That's Hutchinson back out there for the Dewhawks. As well as Edwards and KP. Pritchett gets the handoff. Mm. And for one of the rare times today, he goes nowhere.
Yeah.
So Dewhawks looks like they're still going to run their offense here. Even with close to a minute 30 left here. I mean, they still got 25 seconds on play clock, but it looks like they're it looks like they've kind of slowed it down here a little bit. So play clock has now just hit 15 seconds. And game clock is just hit a minute 20. Hutchinson hands off to Pritchett again. Bouncing on the outside. Hurdles over a man for the first down. Dewhawks count down to a minute left here on homecoming weekend. And it's been a successful one at that.
Yeah. Just a little bit more than successful. Yeah.
So Dewhawks will take their time on this play. 15 seconds on the play clock. Pritchett with another handoff. Gained less than last time, but looks like he got around 3 yards.
Yeah, about bringing up 2nd and 7 with 31 seconds left to go here. Yep.
As this crowd is...
Crowd knows it.
They're going to be able to celebrate officially now.
Yeah.
As they've been celebrating probably since the second quarter or even first quarter.
Yeah. Definitely. Probably since halftime.
And as you see them there, they're all on their feet showing some love to these football players who put in a heck of an effort.
Yeah.
And Adam,
what
did you enjoy seeing out of the Dewhawks today? What do you think they did well today?
I mean, really, everything. Really, you can't. There's not one thing that really stands out. But, I mean, defensively, I mean, if you had to give one side an edge, you'd have to go with the defense. Mm-hmm. I mean, a safety, multiple interceptions, a lot of turnovers from the Beavers.
Didn't allow any points either.
Yeah, no points. Big shutout, but yeah. I mean, everything was rolling for them, and unfortunately for BV, just couldn't get anything going. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's hard to win football games when you can't get really anything. You're having a lot of turnovers, but absolutely.
And as you see the cheerleaders dancing there, that's what we'll do. We'll dance right on out of here. Catch us next time as on October 22nd when Lawrence takes on Co. They're at Simpson next week. It's been a pleasure. Happy homecoming. Stay safe, everybody.
We'll see you guys.